Just keeping you fit.
Good morning, everybody. We are very lucky today to have the Reverend William Sanders with us. He likes to be called Bill. He's brought his lovely wife Alice with him. She's going to keep him in order.
She really does.
Would you like to sit down? And I'm going to ask Julian if he'll start our service with a hymn or a song. Thank you, Julian. Dearly beloved brothers and sisters, the scripture moves us in so many places to acknowledge and confess our manifold sins and wickedness, and that we should not dissemble nor cloak them before the face of Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, but confess them with a humble serve today when we assemble and meet together to render thanks for the great benefits that we have received at his hands, to set forth his most worthy praise, to hear his most holy word, and to ask those things which are requisite and necessary, as well for the body as the soul. Wherefore I pray and beseech you, as many as are here present, to accompany me with a pure heart and a humble voice unto the throne of heavenly grace, saying with me, Almighty and most merciful Father, we have erred and strayed from thy ways like a sheep. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against our own wills. We have left undone those things which we ought to have done, and we have done those things which we ought not to have done. And there is no help in us, but thou, O Lord, have mercy upon us, miserable offenders. Spare not those, O God, who express their faults. Restore our religious or repentance, according to thy promises, declared unto mankind, in Christ Jesus our Lord, and grant to the most merciful Father, in his name, that we may hereafter live godly, righteous, and sober life, to the glory of thy holy name. Amen.
Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who desireth not the death of a sinner, but rather that he may turn from his wickedness and live, hath given power and commandment to his ministers to declare and pronounce to his people, being penitent, the absolution and remission of their sins. Pardoneth and absolveth all those who truly repent and unfailingly believe in his holy gospel. Wherefore let us beseech him to grant us true repentance and his Holy Spirit, that those things may please him which we do at this present, and that the rest of our life hereafter may be pure and holy, so that at the last we may come to his eternal joy. Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Please join in with me in the words of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
O Lord, open our lips.
Thy mouth shall show forth thy praises.
O God, make speed to save us.
O Lord, make haste to help us.
Peace now.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Praise you, the Lord.
Lord, to him be praised.
Please sit for the first reading.
Since there's no song, we'll do both readings together. And so, our first reading is from Colossians, chapter 3, verses 12 to 17. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other, and forgive one another if any of you has a grievance against someone. Forgive as the Lord forgave you, and over all these virtues put on love, which binds them all together with perfect unity. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you were called to peace. And be thankful. Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly, as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom through psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, Do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father. Second reading is from the Gospel of Matthew, and that's chapter 24, and beginning at the 30th verse. Then will appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven, and then all the peoples of the earth will mourn when they see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. And he will send his angels with a loud trumpet call. They will gather his elect from the four winds, from one end of the heavens to the other. Now learn this lesson from the fig tree. As soon as its twigs get tender and its leaves come out, you know that summer is near. Even so, when you see all these things, you know that it is near, right at the door. Truly I tell you, this generation will certainly not pass away until all these things have happened. Heaven and earth will pass away, my words will never pass away. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Would you like to stand? We're going to join in the words of the Jubilate. We're going to say them, not sing them. Oh, be joyful in the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness, and come before his presence with a song. Be ye sure of the Lord. He is God. It is he that hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people, and the sheep of his pasture. O go your way into his fields with thanksgiving, and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him, and speak word of his name. The Lord is gracious, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endures from generation to generation.
The Lord be to the Father, and to the Ghost, as one was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
I'm going to remain standing while we join in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God,
the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, life everlasting. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Let us pray. We say together the Lord's Prayer of Him. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Give us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
The Lord show thy mercy upon us,
and grant us thy salvation.
O Lord, save the Queen.
And bless the fields of the poor among them.
Do thy ministers with righteousness,
and make thy churches to be joyful.
O Lord, save thy people,
and bless thy inheritance.
Give peace in our time, O Lord.
Cause the rich and poor that are fighting for us, but let them go,
O God. O God, make clean our hearts within us,
and take not thy Holy Spirit from us.
The call for peace. O God, who art the author of peace and lover of concord, in knowledge of whom stand our eternal life, whose service is perfect freedom, defend us, thy humble servants, in
all the souls of our enemies, that we, surely trusting in thy defense, may not fear the power of any adversaries, through the might of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And we say with the covenant of grace together. O Lord, our heavenly Father, almighty and everlasting God, who has saved and brought us to the beginning of this day, defend us in the same with thy mighty power, and grant that this day we fall into no sin, neither run into any kind of danger, but that all our doings may be ordered by thy goodness, may be righteous in thy sight, through Jesus Christ our Lord. You said, Lord, in your mercy, please respond with hear our prayer. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray today for the ministers of your church, for our archbishops, for our bishops, for our archdeacons, for all the ministers churches throughout the country. Through the minister of our church, Ali and Ebali. And we pray, Lord, that she is enjoying her break from us all. And we pray for Bill and for Alice and for their extended family and for all of the retired ministers who are still ministering. Keep them all safe, Lord. Look after each and every one of them. And look after the congregations that they are ministering to. Keep us all safe in your care. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the Queen and the members of Parliament, for all who have authority and the decisions that affect every person in this nation. We pray that they have the right decisions, that they work for the good of all the people, not just a few, but not the many, but everyone. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the members of our local community, for all the volunteers who are working very hard, who are looking after people that they don't know. We pray for the food banks. We pray for the teachers in the school. We pray that everyone who is working hard has time to rest as well as to work. We pray for the children, for their holiday. Since the clocks have moved back, we pray for the children who are out playing when it goes dark. We pray for their safety, Lord. This time of year, there are always road traffic accidents. Keep the children safe, Lord. They are not the future. They are our present. They are your present. They are the ones who are bringing your kingdom nearer and nearer to the rest of us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for those today who are sick. We pray for the ones that we know, and the ones that are known only to you. But we pray especially for Joseph, for Bill, for Chris, for Suzanne, for Leah. You know the reason for these prayers, Lord. Keep them safe. Make them well. And if you need them, bring them safe to your kingdom. Look after the doctors and nurses who are looking after these people. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, we all grieve. Every one of us here has
We see our families, no more. We see our friends, no more. But they are with you. We believe this because you said that they would come to you. Look after them, Lord. But give us some comfort. Give us some help. Bring us your peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Join together in the words of the Lord and merciful Father, accept
this request for the sake of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Out to other people so that they also can be saved. So we have a role. Can you put your hand up if you don't mind being interrupted? If you easily speak to other people about your faith, about Jesus, do you have a testimony that you can actually, yeah, put your hand up? Does that mean? So most people don't feel comfortable then. Would that be right? It's terrible with the mask, isn't it? Because we can't really, I can't see your face and I can't see whether you're smiling or not. But the fact is, it's many people do find it difficult. And so I wonder why that is, because at the end of the day, what Jesus says is that we really must come to the cross and understand why he had to go and die there. I'm sure, you know, that's basic to what we're doing. I'm sure the ministers here have preached that faithfully over the years. But we really need to understand what happens when we make that confession of faith, when we repent and ask for God's forgiveness. And understand that Jesus there was in our place so that the judgment of God would not fall upon us. It fell upon him for everything all of us had ever done wrong. And so it's important to understand what that means. And as we do understand it, and we come into this relationship with Jesus, we begin to grow and to walk in that book. The reality is, we need to remember we have to be rescued, we have to be saved, and so do all the other people in our generation, if they want to be with Christ together. Now, I think you probably know that I work with fire service here, and there's a situation which is desperate. And we were called to a fire, and it was a fire where somebody was killed. And what happened was, as we opened the doors, the fire was going well at the back of the house, and there were two people in it. There was a man, the father, an older man, and his son. There was also a man, obviously, much younger. And as they were called to come out to us so that we could bring them out to safety, to rescue them, the father came out, but the son suddenly turned around. Maybe he'd forgotten something, I don't know. But he went back into the flames and he was killed. So we had to retrieve the body later on. And it's a bit like that, although we don't often see it in these terms. The reason Jesus went to the cross was to rescue people, to save them for eternity. Often, when we try to talk to people about the Lord and what he's done for us, what he wants for us, and the fact that Jesus came to rescue us through the cross, many people will not accept that message for whatever reason. And so they turn away, turn back, if you like, and ultimately that means that they will not be with the Lord because they have chosen a different path. But the Lord is clear that we are called to tell people, and we can do that in many ways, including sharing what God has done. So, does God speak to you today? Have you made that commitment? That's the first thing. We all have to look at that. And we also have to make sure that we're keeping that relationship with Jesus going. And sometimes we have to dedicate ourselves. So, do you have a testimony to share? What has God done in your life? Has he spoken to you? Have you ever heard him speak to you? Have you ever seen him work for you? Because that's what he wants to do. Now we're like the person in the gorilla suit and the lion suit. Often, we pretend to be something that we're not. And I'll bet you that all of you are not what you appear to be as you sit here. Because all of us have things in our lives which we're ashamed of, or weaknesses that we don't want anybody to know. so we put on front what we hide behind the mask of God. Now, if we doubt what I'm saying to with respect to that, all I ask you is, if we have a screen up here, would you be happy for all the things that you've ever thought, said, or done to come up on that screen for everybody here to see? Hands up if you would be happy for that. Anybody at all? So I take it that you wouldn't. I know I wouldn't. There are just some things that I'd be totally ashamed of. Things I'd be worried about, like what I was thinking about you or you last week when you said something horrible to me. I think I was smashing your face in and all that kind of stuff. We wouldn't like that. And so what we do is we hide behind this mask. Or we pretend we're someone that we want. Now when we come into the relationship with Jesus, he begins to change all that. Because he begins to heal us. And the more time we spend with him, and the further we walk with him, bit by bit, what should happen is that we should become more like Christ. And as that happens, we will not then be afraid for people to see us as we really are. So as God's church, that's what we're called to. Not just to commit our lives to Jesus, but to walk with him and allow him to change us. So that our testimony there to other people who need to be saved and rescued will become effective much more. And you will become more confident to speak about what he's doing in your life. But I just want to read something out here. And this really goes on to the first reading that we had today from Colossians. And it's a letter, really, written by a man to his boss or something like that. And it's entitled, Those Christians. And this is what he says in the letter. The Christians are not differentiated from other people by country, language, or customs. They do not live in cities of their own, or speak some strange dialect, or have some peculiar lifestyle. This teaching of theirs has not been contrived by the invention and speculation of inquisitive men, nor are they propagating mere human teaching as some people do. They live in both Greek and foreign cities, wherever chance has brought them. They follow local customs in clothing, food, and the other aspects of life. But at the same time, they demonstrate to us the wonderful and certainly unusual form of their own citizenship. They live in their own native lands, but as aliens. As citizens, they share all things with others, but like aliens, suffer all things. Every foreign country is to them as their native country, and every native land as a foreign country. They marry and have children just like everyone else, but they do not kill unwanted babies. They offer a shared table, but not a shared bed. They are a present in the flesh, but they do not live according to the flesh. They are passing their days on earth, but are citizens of heaven. They obey the appointed laws and go beyond the laws of their own lives. They love everyone, but are persecuted by all. They are unknown and condemned. They are put to death and gain life. They are poor, and yet make many rich. They are short of everything, and yet have plenty of all things. They are dishonored, and yet gain glory through dishonor. Their names are blackened, and yet they are cleared. They are mocked and blessed in return. They are treated outrageously and behave respectfully to others. When they do good, they are punished as evildoers. When punished, they rejoice as if being given new life. They are attacked by Jews as aliens and are persecuted by Greeks, yet those who hate them cannot give any reason for their hostility. To put it simply, the soul is to the body as Christians are to the world. The soul is spread through all parts of the body, and Christians through all the cities of the world. The soul is in the body, but is not of the body. Christians are in the world, but not of the world. And that was written in the 2nd century to probably a Greek overlord or whatever. But that's the way they lived their lives, and it made a difference. Despite all that was happening to them, they responded with respect and love to all those around them. And of course, we know that the church grew exponentially from those times right through to our present day. And I don't know if you would see yourself as a person who lives and behaves like that. Certainly there are plenty who don't. Nevertheless, this is what the Lord wants to do with us, for us, and through us. Not just that we can be saved and rescued by Jesus, but so that all of them can, as far as possible, as well. And it's possible for you to do that. Now you might think, I remember when we were first in church, when we first became Christians, when we were in our 20s, all of a sudden, there were ministers in the church who began to talk like I'm talking to you now. What they said was, the Lord gives power for every one of us to be able to share our faith, to live as we ought, and to allow God's power to work through us, to touch people's lives and change them around. So God will speak to us to give somebody a message about their lives, which is life-changing for them. Or he'll give us the ability to pray healing for them, or to pray with them to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. Are you baptized in the Holy Spirit? If you go and pray for somebody now to lay hands on them and ask the Holy Spirit to come into them, will you see it happen, do you think? Are you confident that it will? I assure you, Jesus promised that he would do that through his people. Not just ministers, not just musicians, but all people like you who want together the body of Christ. So you ought to be able to pray with people and see them filled with God's Holy Spirit, and to see the gifts of the Holy Spirit working through you and then through them. This is what God wants. This is how he's equipping us to reach out and change our generation. Are you confident that God can do that through you? I want to tell you, he can, and he will. So when I was a young minister, this is just an example, we had Billy Graham preaching in Germany. So in Toxteth, which is where we were at the time, they set up this thing that, you know, don't know what it was called in those days, but they could record what was happening, show it on video, whatever it was. Billy Graham preaching. And they'd invited a whole load of people to the church to watch it. And so Billy Graham did this normal thing, and then at the end of his preaching, he gave an invitation for people to come to Christ. And of course, if you've ever been to one of his rallies, hundreds and thousands of people would respond to him. God's work through him during his life and ministry. So, what they were doing in the church where we were in Toxteth, once they listened to that, the ministers there gave them an invitation to come forward, to commit their lives to Christ. And a number of them did. So I was one of the ministers who was sitting there to talk to people afterwards. One of the ministers brought a big lad over to me. And he was a heavyweight boxer. So we sat down. And I said to him, "You're a heavyweight?" "Yeah, yeah," he said. He said, "I listened to what the man had to say." And he said, "I went forward and I prayed the prayer that he invited me to pray. So I gave my life to Jesus." He said, "But what happens now?"
someone thought, oh, I feel what he's saying is, you know, is this real? Is what I just done real? So I said to him, tell you what, stand up and can I pray with you? And ask the Lord to show you what we've done is real. He went, yeah, all right. And he was like 3 times my size. And he stood up and I put my hands on his head like that. And I prayed a simple prayer. Lord, this man has responded to you, but he needs to know that what he's done is real. Will you show him? And as I prayed that, he fell over backwards, flat out on the floor, as the power of God came. And I sat down, was on the ground for maybe a couple of minutes. When this big man got up, he sat down in his chair, he was shaking like a leaf, and he put his hands in his head. And he went, I've never experienced anything like that in my life. He said, now I know it's real. And from that moment on, he went on with the Lord. So that's what God will do when we're confident that he will use us to speak to and to minister to people around us. And you are not exempt from that. If you can do it through me, certainly do it through you. He doesn't just do it through ministers. And my wife and I have begun to see all the things that ministers were in our church who are beginning to talk about all this actually happened. And you know, we went off to Oxford to train for a Christian. No one, nothing. And God had promised that for the 2 years we were training, he would provide everything that we needed. And that's exactly what happened. Came from all different sources, and we've never had any problem with money. God's promise is that he will do as he has said he will. And you are part of that. And he wants to do those things with you individually and as the body of Christ in this place. Begin to believe that the power of God, just as it worked in the time of the disciples, will work through this church, through all of you, as you begin to allow him to show you what he wants of you. This is his call for everyone. And this is his call for you. Are you willing? And will you allow him to use you? Turn to the way of this. What he will do. If he will allow him, he will show you that many, many people will come to faith because of your ministry and your allowing him to work in power by his Holy Spirit in the name of Jesus to touch the lives of people everywhere, even those who have been rejected by society. I'm some rich people. So there it is. That's an invitation to all of you. That comes from the Lord himself. You are special. You are called. And as you offer everything, even the fault of it, Jesus will take it and will turn it into something special. So, that's all I want to say. I hope you'll take that up and think about it and pray about it. I know that Ali's got things planned, hasn't she, for the future, you know, some courses that we can do, where we do proper ministry. And I'll share this one with you, one, before we go, if you're comfortable. If I've shared this with you before, I don't apologize, I mean, you probably would like to hear it again. But we had, an influx of students and postgraduates, many of them were medics and doctors and so on, in the church that we've just retired from. And we did an alpha course with them. And there was one man there called Dave Handy. And he was mad with God because his cousin had committed suicide, or completed suicide, I should say. So he was coming to church.
what he was deliberately, like a protest, sitting outside of the mall with the groups of people. Anyway, we did the offer, of course, and he went through it, and all the folk in that group came to faith in Christ. And so afterwards, I said, we'll do another one, but I'd like all of you to help me to do it. So we went along to one of the houses. One of these people was a psychiatrist, we were in this house, and we got to the bit where I said, well, if we're going to minister to people, we've got to actually do it, so you may as well start with yourselves. So please stand up and begin to pray for each other, for healing or whatever it is. Now Dave Pandian, this lad, who was, mad with God, had come along, but as usual was sitting out, he didn't get up when they were all praying. But things began to happen. Anyway, we did that, as I said, and just as we went to go on, this Dave Pandian shouted, Bill, I said, yeah, what's up, Dave? He went, can God heal, even if you haven't asked him to? And I said, yeah, of course he can. He said, well, you've just healed me. He said, he was a martial arts fighter, and he'd come in with injuries, and he couldn't move his neck, and was in real pain. And he felt his two of his fingers were strapped because he felt the throat was broken. And he said, well, he's just healed me, he said. I can move my fingers, and there's no pain. And so I can heal him. Now he committed his life to Christ that night because of that happened. And it happened because the people stood up very tentatively to do what I've asked them to do, to pray for each other, that the power of God would come. And God turned up, and that is the result. Now, me and Alice have seen that hundreds of times over the time that we've been Christian, through ourselves and through other people, just like ourselves. So we want this church to be strong, but let's step out of faith and let God work through you. I promise you, He will.
Very powerful words. I think we all would like to say thank you to God for a lovely sermon after coming to take our service for us. And if you were in any way moved by that, you can phone Cindy up tomorrow and book your place for next week, because Bill is back next week to do the service for us. And we'll continue to pray that Ali enjoys her holiday and maybe wants to do a sermon another week on Mom after that, and Bill can come and take the next service as well. Jack's smiling. Don't tell him more. She'll only get older than him. We're going to ask Jack and Julian if they'd like to do us our final hymn or song, and then we'll ask Bill to do the blessing for us. Can I, before they start, ask you to remain in your seats after the service is finished, because one of the church wardens will come and tell you it's your turn to leave, so that we're not all bunched up at the back at the end of the service. Lots of nodding heads. Thank you very much. Thank you, Julian.
Oh,
The God of all grace, who called you to his eternal glory in Christ Jesus, establish, strengthen, and settle you in the faith. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always.